Hallelujah. Come on, somebody shout aloud, hallelujah. Praise be to God. I want to thank God for this wonderful time. Somehow today, the Lord has been emphasizing me to speak a little on worship. So last weekend, I was in the city of Jabalpur in Madhya Pradesh. I know the church has been praying. Really want to thank every one of you for upholding us and backing us up in prayer. Really want to give God the glory. And just to testify for the glory of God, some of the services were unstoppable. Some of the worship services were unstoppable. My brother-in-law Rohan was with me, and we had to forcefully stop some of the services. And the outpouring of the Holy Ghost was so powerful. I went back to my place. I was seated there. God was still doing His work. That's how God works. Amen. Hallelujah. So thank God for your prayer support, and I really want to thank each one of you for taking time to back us up in prayer. This morning, also want to announce the movement that has been taking place in our church for the last 1 week. We all know it. It is called the prayer movement, a very powerful movement. If there's anything that can move the heart of God, if there's anything that can change our lives, it's prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. And I love the title of this movement. It's called as Fast Forward. Somebody say Fast Forward. Fast Forward. Fast Forward, right? Praise God. When do we fast forward? When do we move fast forward? We had the tape recorders, right, in the beginning. So if you don't like a particular whenever we used to watch movies and all, we don't like a certain song, we used to fast forward. And you can see that sound also, like, okay, so fast forward. But in the kingdom of God, the Bible doesn't encourage us to move forward fastly. We have to be steadfast in God. But yesterday I was talking to a few pastors from the northern part of India, and they've been discussing with me the situation in the state of Uttar Pradesh. And now yesterday I told them about our prayer movement, and I said this is a time for people who have gone back to move fast forward. This is a time for us to take a step ahead. We have to move ahead. We have to push ourselves. We have to be self-motivated. We don't need anybody to come and push. We have to fast forward because the time is near. Amen. How many of you believe this? The time is near. And I'm sure the Lord is about to do a great transformation. God is about to bring a great transformation. And this is the time people of God who have been taking the back seat to be moving forward. You have to literally fast forward. You have to literally jump to the place which God has called you to. Amen. Hallelujah. This is not the time for us to move forward or stay in the same place. I was in the forces, and very, very common command. I'm sure that the people in the NCC and all must be aware of this. There's a command called piche mud. But in the kingdom of God, there is no piche mud. We have to keep moving ahead. We have to keep looking ahead. And the Bible approves that the people who look behind, the people who look at the back, they cannot accomplish anything for the kingdom of God. Amen. The people who are in the habit of looking behind will never ever accomplish anything for the kingdom of God. You see, David, when he was confronted by Goliath, he did not look back. Though he was a small kid, he had to march ahead. Amen. He went ahead. Though he was too big, too huge for this small boy, but yet David did not look back. Even though the whole nation of Israel were mere spectators to this to tantrums of this evil one, yet this man, this small boy, moved ahead. When Moses was struck between the Philistine army and the Red Sea, Philistines and the Red Sea, still, you know what God said? Move ahead. Move ahead. So this is the time. If you're in the habit of receiving the word, please receive this. This is time for the people of God to move. Can you tell somebody, this is the time to move? Amen. Hallelujah. This is the time to move. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. So this morning, I have a few things to share, and I'm sure even as you catch up with these points, we're going to see something happening in our lives. because the word changes lives. Amen. Hallelujah. So a few days back, I think a few weeks back, Pastor Benson was talking about Psalms 18, which talks about the broad places. Any of you remember? Broad places, okay? Psalms 18 talks about broad places. Some places you will also find it as wide places. The Bible also talks about dark places. The Bible also talks about dry places. The Bible also talks about high places. Okay. Psalms 18 talks about the high place. It says, I will lift you up and keep you on the high place. But whereas when we look at the Old Testament, the high places were places which were usually commonly detestable to God. High places, some kings who walked in accordance to the word of God brought down the high places, but few kings who did not walk in accordance to the will of God brought down the high places. Are you understanding? Kings who loved God brought down the high places. Kings who did not walk in the way of God built the high places. Now, high places were something that were detestable to God in His sight. Amen. Now, high places were places which commonly represented false worship, idolatry, few things which God did not like. And when I began to meditate on these high places, I came to a conclusion in my mind, knowingly or unknowingly, intentionally or unintentionally, you and I have certain high places in our lives which we need to identify, bring them down, put God in that high place. Amen. Hallelujah. So we are all in the... So I'm not going to speak something new. Like I told you last time, I'm here to remind you what you already know. I'm here to remind you what we have already learned. See, Paul the Apostle in many of the epistles, he said, I've come to remind you. So we all need reminders. If what I read or study in my school or college, if I go back, if I don't revise, I may not be able to understand. I may not be able to contain what I learned. So it is essential for me to have reminders. Amen. So this morning, this comes as a reminder. So every day we need to recheck, re-examine, retrospect our lives and see if there is anything that is taking the place of God in our lives. If there is anybody, anything that is taking the place of God that becomes the high place of our life, whether we like it, whether we don't like it. For some people, it is their boyfriend or the girlfriend that has taken the first place in their life. For some people, it is their spouses who have taken that first place in their lives. For some people, it is their parents. For some people, it is their relatives. For some people, it is their employers. For some people, it is their friends. For some people, it is their pastors. For some people, it is their ministries. For some people, some man of God somewhere. For some people, their own self have become the high place. So I'm not against it, but I want you to identify such places, such people who have taken that high place in your life, bring them down to the second place, put God in the first place, because He deserves to be in that high place, in that first place. Because what happens is, when I have something, when I have somebody in that first place, my mind is pondering over them or over that particular thing all the time. If I have my girlfriend, I keep thinking, hey, how should I please my girlfriend? What should I give her so that she would smile at me? What should I do to her so that she would be pleased with me? So all the time, night and day, I keep thinking about her, and knowingly or unknowingly, she is becoming an object of worship in my life. The one who takes the first place in my life becomes an object of worship. So this morning I encourage the body of Christ to bring down all such things, all such people to the second place. Put God in the first place, because He's the only one who deserves to be worshipped. He's the only one who deserves to be taking the first high place in our lives. Amen. Hallelujah. Now God told Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac,
and offer him at Mount Moriah. Now here is Abraham. The Bible says he acted immediately. He agreed immediately. He consented immediately without a second thought. He took his son Isaac and he went to the mount. Okay. Now he went to the mount along with the servants. The Bible talks about this in the book of Genesis chapter 22. And he was tying Isaac. Now the meaning of this word Isaac means joy. The meaning of this word Isaac means laughter. Now God specifically said, give your only son. Give your only son. Or sacrifice your joy, your laughter to me at the altar. Now this man was a man who was very, very obedient. And the Bible says he went there. He began to tie. He was about to go. He told his servants. You know what he told his servants? In Genesis chapter 22, the Bible says, stay here. We'll go yonder and worship. And we will come back. Now, we must understand that is the first term. If you read Genesis chapter 22, I want you to turn with me to Genesis chapter 22, verses 5. The Bible says, and Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey, the lad, and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. Now that is the first time in the Bible this term worship is used. Okay, now Abraham tells his servants, now you stay here, I will go yonder, I will worship, and we will come back. Now, he's supposed to be coming back alone. He should be using a plural called I will sacrifice him, I will come back. But here he says, I will worship, and we will come back. Now, understand that when we offer that worship unto God, that sacrificial worship, that selfless worship unto God, there is something that God begins to change and transform our lives. Amen. Hallelujah. And this is the first time you'll ever find a term called worship in the Bible. The Bible says he came and he praised God. He worshipped God. Amen. I want you to understand, this term called high place is the place that only God deserves. If you read Psalms 18, like Pastor Benson spoke the other day, Psalms 18 talks about, I will lift you up and keep you up on the high place. Now, the high place has a dual meaning. It is used twice in the Bible. It also talks about God detesting when somebody else takes that place of God. And also, God assuring his people who walks in accordance to his will, giving that high place. I will set your feet upon that high place. Now, high place is not an ordinary place. It's an amazing place. And James 4:8 says, if you come nigh to me, I am going to come nigh to you. If we take one step, he's going to take four for us. Amen. Hallelujah. So it's very, very essential that God take that first place in our lives, because God is the one who deserves worship. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Can you tell your neighbor, God deserves worship? God deserves worship. Only God deserves worship and nobody else. Amen. Hallelujah. Now worship, people have this misconception. Many people have this misconception. Worship is something that permits me to come late to the house of God. Worship is something that gives me permission to come late to the church. We have the technology, WhatsApp. I will begin to send a message to my friend. Are worship ho gaya kya? Worship last song hoga tab bata dena, main aa jaunga. People have this misconception. Praise and worship is not for the people to come late to the house of God. If you fail to give God the worship, even if you come and listen to the word for 4 hours, it will not make any difference. Because worship, praise and worship, is the only thing that you and I can give to God. Nothing else. When we offer God the praise and worship, we minister unto God. And when we listen to the word, God ministers unto us. And that's why it's very, very essential for us to be on time so that we could give the best worship unto God. Amen. Hallelujah. Now praise. Now there is a difference between praise and worship. Praise is something that we give thanks to God for what he has done in our lives. Now worship is telling God what he is to your life. Telling God, impressing God. Telling God how much important he is to you. Telling God what he means to you. Amen. So we usually, if we don't have this idea of worship, and we mess up. Some people pray during worship. Some people sing thanksgiving during worship. No. give God, the kingdom of God works very, very orderly. And it is very, very essential for us to come prepared so that when we give God the praise and worship, we should give him the best. Amen. David, King David, is called to be a worshiper. And when he worshiped God, he forgot that he was a king. He gave the best to God. He was being disrobed of his kingly garments that represented splendor, majesty, honor, were falling off his body because he was involved, he was entangled, he was engrossed in worshiping God because God was his priority. He did not even care his position. He did not even bother his status because God was his priority. God was his status. He knew God was his number one in his life. That's why he gave the best to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, when we worship God, we need to tell God what he is to you. There's a song that says, Christina sang that song, "What a Friend We Have, Jesus." We're telling God, "Lord, what a..." He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Amen. Telling God, "Lord, there is none beautiful than you. You are beautiful beyond description." You're worshiping God. "Lord, you are the one who deserves that first place. What a friend are you, O God." Amen. "He is the lily of the valley. He is the rose of Sharon. He is the fairest of 10,000. When you tell God, you are actually worshiping God. And when you worship God, you are touching the heart of God. When you worship God, the only thing that can please God is the worship of his people. And when we worship God in purity, in spirit, and in truth, we are touching the heart of God. You know what Jesus said in John chapter 4, verses 23 and verse 24. Jesus said, a time is coming, and now is the time where my Father is seeking for worshipers who will worship me in spirit and in truth." Now this term called seek, S-E-E-K, in Greek it is called as darash, D-A-R-A-S-H, which means hunting eagerly. The literal meaning of this word seek: my Father is hunting eagerly for worshippers who will worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. And if he finds you, if you are found by him. If you are the worshipper who worships him in spirit and in truth, you are found by God. Amen. Hallelujah. So when you begin to worship God in purity, in the holiness, you are touching the heart of God. You are pleasing God. Amen. Hallelujah. Now worship is not something that can be taught. Worship is not something that can be taught. Okay. Most of the times the worship leaders, they become the PD teachers. Lift up your left hand. Lift up your right hand. Lift up your legs. Lift up your feet. Everybody kneel down. Everybody fall prostrate. No. Worship is an attitude. Somebody say, worship is an attitude. Can you look to your neighbor, tell them, worship is an attitude. Worship is an attitude. It cannot be taught. It has to be instinct. It has to be bubbling on the inside of your heart. You don't have to wait for somebody. Lift up your hands. If you are a worshiper, you will forget who's standing beside you. You will just involve in touching the heart of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Worship is an attitude. It should come from the inside of your heart. Amen. And when it comes to the posture of worship, when it comes to the worship posture, the Bible does not specify anywhere. The Bible does not specify this is a particular posture that has to be followed during worship. Nowhere you will find posture. But the history says whenever King David worshiped God, he put his head in between his knees and worshiped God. And this was a very, very painful act. And that was his usual posture. Whenever it came to worshiping God, he literally put his head between his knees and worshiped God. There is freedom. The Bible says there is liberty in the presence of God. There is no particular posture when it comes to worshiping God. Okay. You can sit and worship God. Some people stand and worship God. Some people lift their hands and worship God. Some people fall prostrate. Some people kneel and worship God. Some people cry during worship. Some people smile during worship. Some people rejoice during worship. Some people literally sob during worship. It's okay. There is no particular posture. You have freedom in the presence of God. But the Bible says in Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, the Bible, Paul the Apostle, in writing to the Roman church said, I, in view of God's mercy, I beseech you, brethren, that you offer your bodies as living sacrifices, because it determines your spiritual act of worship. The way you stand, the way you kneel, the way you sit, the way your body should represent and determine reverence for the presence of God. We should bring reverence. Our bodies should determine that reverence for God, because it's a spiritual act of worship. I don't like people sitting like this during worship services. I don't like people putting their hands in the pocket and keep looking. I'm not talking about you. You're all good people. I'm talking about somebody else. Okay. Putting their hands in the pockets and looking at people. They form governments during worship. Hey, ya government banti vatta? Karnataka government yaad banta? Hey, Congress munday tappa? During worship, your bodies determine your spiritual act of worship. Some people come make the sound of the chairs. When somebody is involved in worship, they come and make the sound of the chairs, bringing disturbance to the entire body of Christ, entire sanctuary where people are involved in worshiping God. Please don't do that, because we are in the process of revering the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who is number one in our lives and who determines, who deserves that one place, that first place for worship. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. I always believe this. Before you could fulfill the calling of God upon your life, one should fulfill the calling of a worshiper first. Before you become, you fulfill the calling of the fivefold ministry or whatever ministries you've been called upon your life, I believe you have to fulfill the calling of a worshiper. Amen. Because in heaven, there is no teaching of God's word. In heaven, there is no preaching of God's word. In heaven, there is only one thing, that is worship. Amen. Hallelujah. So what we do on the earth is a rehearsal of the final take which is going to happen there. So give your best. Give your best worship unto God. Let's not make fun of somebody when it comes to worship. Let's not keep smiling. Arey, uska dekho, uska chehra dekho. We've done this enough. Now it's time to give God the best. Some people don't even bother to put their phones on silent mode or whatever it is, vibration or whatever they call it. Okay. If I always encourage the youngsters, if there is anybody or anything that is more important than God for you or worshiping God, then the house of God is not the right place for you. Because if you come, keep everything aside. Keep everything aside. I was ministering in a church in Delhi. There was a scroll behind me. Put your phones in silent mode or vibration mode. I told them, vibration cut karo bhai. Vibration is sometimes more dangerous than the sound itself. Some dangerous. So let them switch the phones off, because when you are in the house of God, nothing should disturb you. And when nothing disturbs you, nothing is going to happen as well. Because God is in control. When you give God the best, I want you to know, I want you to understand that God is in control. He's taking care of everything. You don't have to worry about your business. You don't have to worry about somebody who's sick. You don't have to worry about anything outside. God is in absolute control. Amen. Hallelujah. So give God the best. Come on, look to your neighbor. Tell them, give God the best. Give God the best. I want you to focus on this scripture, John chapter 4 and verse 24. Jesus said, a time is coming and now is the time. Tell your neighbor, now is the time. Now is the time. Tell your neighbor, now is the time. Where Father is seeking for whom, you know? Worshippers. Worshippers. A worship that comes from a true heart, a holy heart, is something that can stir up the heart of God. Amen. Now I want you to understand that when we become worshippers, there are a few blessings that follow being a worshipper. Okay, we're going to look into that. If you have your Bibles with you, I want you to turn with me to the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 23. Exodus chapter 23. You know, somebody said like this, a church grows clearer by worship, closer by fellowship, purer by discipleship, stronger by ministry, larger by outreach. Amen. I repeat, a church grows clearer by worship, closer by fellowship, purer by discipleship, stronger by ministry, larger by outreach. It made sense. That's why I noted it down. Amen. Clearer by worship. Clearer by worship. At the end of the message, I'm going to tell you what the Lord has put in my heart for the church. Okay. Now, Exodus chapter 23, verses 25 says like this. Verses 25. I want you to look up to me on the screen. Okay. Worship the Lord your God. Somebody say worship. Worship. The Bible says worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be upon your food and water. If you are a worshiper, I want you to understand that there are certain blessings that follow as an inheritance. There are certain blessings that follow you of being a worshiper. And what is the blessing? The blessing, the Bible says, his blessing shall be upon your food and water. How many of you pray before you eat? Only two? Only three? How many of you pray before you eat? I'm not talking about P-R-E-Y. I am asking a P-R-A-Y. How many of you pray before you eat? What do you pray? Young people, tell me. What do you pray? What do you pray before you eat? Bless the food, right? Bless the food. Is that what we pray? Is that what we pray? Lord, thank you for the food. We pray that you bless the food, right? Okay. Now the Bible says, when you are a worshiper, his blessing shall be upon your food and water. And somebody shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 21 years I've been in the ministry. I've been to every state, almost every state in India. I've gone to villages, I've gone to towns, I've gone to metros, I've gone to all kinds of... not everywhere you get a mineral water. Not everywhere you're provided with mineral water. Some places, we were in Orissa, we went to a place in Orissa, and you know, literally, we went to a tribal area. I was ministering there, and the drinking water that they gave was literally yellow in color. Okay, but we drank it because there was no other option. We were in a tribal area. Whatever was set before us, we ate it. Until today, you can ask the other men of God also here. Till today, whatever we have eaten, whatever we have drunk, has never been a problem to us, because the blessing of God has been upon the food and water of a worshiper. Amen. Hallelujah. Sometimes we eat all kinds of nonsense. We begin to bind the devil. And the devil, sitting at a corner, will be taking all the credit. Stop eating all nonsense. But if you are a worshiper, his blessing shall be upon your food and your water. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Don't worry what you eat. If you are a worshiper, I tell you, whatever is laid before you, eat it. Wherever you lead, we follow. Whatever you feed, we swallow. That's what I believe. Amen. Hallelujah. So if you are a worshiper, the blessing of God is automatically upon your food and water. Okay, point number two. Blessing number two. The Bible says in verses 23 and verse 25b. Okay. I will take away sickness from among you. Worship the Lord your God, and I will take away sickness from among you. You shall not be sick. You shall not be weary. You shall not suffer any illness, because you are a worshiper. Somebody shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Bible says, God says, I will take away sickness from among you. I was in Delhi, in the North Campus, the university area. I was in the church there, and the pastor of the church was a lady. And we finished the meeting, and this lady pastor comes to me and says, can you please pray for my dad, who has to undergo a surgery? Can you please pray for successful surgery? I said, we don't pray for successful surgeries. We pray for successful healings. And this man comes and stands before me. And I said, uncle, are you ready to worship with me? And this man looked at me so seriously, like the Ekta Kapoor serial. Not everything happens thrice. Dan, dan, dan. So thrice he looked at me up and down. And I said, however, uncle, we have to pray. We have to worship. And we began to worship God. And this man was so reluctant, because probably he must be having that pain or something. I don't know. but he was very very reluctant, but I made him to worship. The next 20 minutes I made him to worship, and after the meeting I was going back home, and this lady pastor calls me and tells me, "Pastor, thank you so much for praying for my dad. My dad did not have to undergo a surgery because the doctor said he was completely healed." Amen. So I said, "I never prayed for your dad. He worshiped God." Amen. If you worship God, the Bible says, "I will take away sickness from among you." Abraham said, "I will yonder there worship God. We will come back." Abraham knew that the worship is going to change the heart of God. Amen. "I will take away sickness from among you." I encourage the body of Christ, please worship God the best that you can give to God, because when you do that, sickness will not have any place in your bodies. Amen. People sometimes they call me in the midnight hours, 1 o'clock, 1 a.m., 2 a.m., bhaiya dar lag raha hai. I said, "Worship God. I'm not able to sleep." Worship God. Irrespective of what is happening, when you take up your position in worshiping God, something begins to happen. It changes the environment because God takes over. Because Bible says, "I will take away sickness from among you. His blessing shall be upon the food and water. I will take away sickness from among you." Let's continue. Point number 3. The Bible says, "None will miscarry nor be barren in your land." Amen. Hallelujah. None will miscarry. None will be barren in your land. Amen. Hallelujah. A worshiper must understand that he is going to be fruitful all the days of his life, because that's a promise that God gives us. You're not going to miscarry. I'm not only talking about the barrenness of the womb. I'm also talking about the barrenness in the ministry, barrenness in the finances, barrenness in your work, barrenness in whatever you name. It shall not happen if you are a worshiper of God. Hallelujah. It's not going to happen. There's a friend of mine who works with me in the ministry. He stays in Bangalore. His wife miscarried thrice, and the third time he was literally sobbing. He was literally crying. I never saw him cry like that. And I told him, it was in the month of January. She had miscarriage, and she was literally crying. He was literally crying, and I told him, "Don't worry. Your wife is going to conceive in the month of March. She's going to deliver in the month of November. Take this as a word of God." He was shocked. He said, "How?" "Let's worship God." And we began to worship God. Trust me. We began to worship God for some time, and exactly in the month of March, she got conceived. And after conception, was another problem was, she had 3 miscarriages. Now this fellow had already believed, "Arre, 3 bar ho gaya, aur ek bar hoga kya?" So he called me again. "Arre, conception to ho gaya, miscarriage to nahi hoga." I said, "Stupid, don't believe. Just believe, worship God." We began to worship God. It never happened. She never miscarried, nor she was barren. In the month of November, she gave birth to a beautiful girl baby. And praise God, because when you worship God, you will never suffer miscarriages. You will never be barren in your land. You will be fruitful. Amen. Look to your neighbor, tell them, touch them and tell them, "You're going to be fruitful because you're a worshiper." Tell them. Arre, thoda jor se boliye na. Tell them loudly, you are going to be fruitful because you are a worshiper. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Okay, point number 4. The Bible says, verses 23 and 26, "I will give you a full lifespan." A worshiper will have a full lifespan. I want to ask you a question. Anybody wants to die early? Is there anybody who wants to die early? No? If you are a worshiper, you're going to fulfill the number of days that God has kept for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Get up in the morning. Look at the messages some of the groups send. Look at the newspapers. Put on your televisions. Everywhere deaths. Everywhere accidents. Everywhere killings. Everywhere accidental deaths. That building collapsed. This happened. That happened. but I tell you, if you are a worshipper, God says, I'm going to give you a full lifespan. Somebody say, full lifespan. Full lifespan. You're not, you don't have to fear death, because when you are a worshipper, you're going to enjoy the number of days that God has kept for you. Amen. But there is a condition, if you are a worshipper. Amen. Hallelujah. Next point. The Bible says in verses 27, I will send my terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. I will make all your enemies turn their backs and run. Now the Bible says, if you are a worshipper, the terror of God is going to come, is going to go ahead of you. Amen. Now God says, if you are a worshipper, before you enter a city, before you enter a town, before you enter a place, the terror of God is going to go ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation that you encounter, and all your enemies will turn their backs and run away. Amen. Hallelujah. Don't have to fear any individual. We don't have to fear any organization. Are ouring martare, yuring martare. No matter, if you are a worshipper, the terror of God is going to go ahead of you. Amen. When Jehoshaphat, if you read the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 20, I believe I told this a few months back. When Jehoshaphat took up his position, when he led, when the worshippers, the ones, the musicians led the battle. You know, they were the leading forefront in the battle. Behind them were people with arms and ammunition. When they began to praise God, when they began to worship God, the Ammonites and the Moabites, they came in one direction, but they fled in seven different directions. The Bible says, I will send my terror ahead of you. If you are a worshipper, you literally don't have to fear. Amen. Because the terror of God is going to go ahead of you. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to understand, our God is a powerful God. When we worship God, something will begin to happen. Psalms 22 and verse 3. God, the Bible says, God is enthroned on the praises of his people. When we take up our position, the power of God is manifested. God says, I will send my terror ahead of you. When you enter a place, when you enter a state, when you enter a town, the terror of God is already there. The devil's kingdom is already aware. Pastor Anil is going to come to my city. The enemy's camp is already shaken, because a man of God is going to enter that city, the worshipper. Amen. The terror of God will go ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation that you encounter. Amen. There are a few more points which I don't want to share, but I want to encourage the body of Christ. Please take hold of these promises. Please claim it. You know, I don't pray more. I don't pray much. I wait more. I don't pray much. I confess more. I don't pray much. I claim more. I don't pray much. I worship a lot. If you are in the habit of worshiping God alone in your houses, then you will enjoy worship when you gather as a church, as a body of Christ. But if you're not in the habit of worshiping God alone in your closer times of prayer times, I tell you, it will all be news for you. Amen. So this morning, change your attitude. So let's get into a time of worship. I want everybody to rise up to your feet. I want you to give God the best worship. Give God the best worship. Don't worry about the song. It is not about the songs that are sung. It is not about the wordings of that song. It is an attitude. It is your heart. Sing a new song to God this morning. Put aside everything. Tell God, Lord, so-and-so person, so-and-so thing has been taken the first place. Now, this is not going to be the high place. You are going to be my high place, oh God. You come and take that place. Let's give God the due place, because he deserves it. And the next few minutes, maybe another 5 to 10 minutes, I want you to give God the best worship, so that you can move forward. You're going to move fast forward, because you are not in the place where God wanted you to be. This is the time that you will jump, restore, renew, replenish what the Lord has called you for. Come on, give God the best this morning. Don't worry who's standing beside you. Don't worry what song is being sung. Don't worry. Just close your eyes. Involve yourself in the presence of God. And something will happen today in the name of Jesus. You want to come forward at the altars? The altars are open. You can just come forward, begin to worship, because something is going to happen this morning. Deserve it this day, Lord.
Hallelujah.
You deserve the worship of God. Lift up your hands, begin to praise God, begin to worship Him this morning, because He's here. He deserves it. Yes, Lord, we touch Your heart, God, this morning. Tell Him, Lord, I love You. Can you tell this to Him? Tell Him, express your love towards Him this morning. Tell Him, Lord, I love You, O God. I love You more than anyone else in this world. If there is anything, anybody who has taken that place, Lord, we bring it. Forgive us. We give You that first place, O God, because You're the only one who deserves it, O God. Because You deserve it, O God. You are seeking for that worshippers. And I want to be that one who will be found by You.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Jesus.
Give him the best. Don't give Him the second best. Give Him the best worship this morning. He deserves it. He wants to be enthroned on your life. He wants to take that first place. He cannot force Himself on you. Unless you open up.
Karuna se teri nayan dikhata hai, kalban kar meri mujhe bachata hai, jab main pukaru tu do.
you repeat this with me this morning? Because I am a worshipper.
Because I am a worshipper.
The blessing of God shall be upon my food and water.
The blessing of God shall be on my food and water.
Because I am a worshipper.
Because I am a worshipper.
The food and water shall be blessed.
The food and water shall be blessed.
Because I am a worshipper.
Because I am a worshipper.
I will be healed. Because I am a worshipper,
I will not miscarry.
I will not be barren. But
I will be fruitful.
Because I am a worshipper, I shall be fruitful. Because I am a worshipper, I will not die early. I am going to have a full lifespan. Because I'm a worshipper, the terror of God is going to go ahead of me. I shall not fear. I shall not be afraid. Come on, give the Lord a loud clap offering and praise Him this morning. Be that worshipper that God is wanting you to be. Because when you touch the heart of God through worship, it actually changes the environment. It brings a transformation. Amen. Hallelujah. I encourage the body of Christ, the youngsters, come forward. Be a part of this wonderful movement. And this is what the Lord told me to tell you. That the Lord is about to raise a new breed of worshipers. Take this. If you want to note it down. It is on record. The Lord is about to raise a new breed of worshipers. Small children are going to stand up, are going to lead worship. This is what the Lord told me. Either you can be a spectator or you can be a part of the movement by involving in it. Okay, choice is yours. But I encourage the body of Christ, come, be a part of this movement. Let's build the kingdom of God together. Amen. Hallelujah. So God bless you. The Lord make you a worshiper in spirit and in truth. God bless you. Amen. Hallelujah.
Church.